Welcome to an introductory video tutorial on the external coincidence model of photoperiodic flowering. This tutorial was narrated and produced by Jay Dandeker and Clara O under the guidance of Dr. Katya Bonaldi and Dr. Susan Golden. Thanks to their biological clocks, plants make complex calculations using information from the environment to orchestrate many physiological processes such as flowering, plant growth, pathogen defense, and gene expression. This clock regulation allows plants to provide physiological responses that are appropriate either to a specific time of day, such as the stoma opening that occurs every day at dawn, or a specific season, like flowering, which only occurs during long days in the model plant Arabidopsis thaliana. The change in daylight length at a specific location throughout the year, also called photoperiod, is entirely predictable from one year to another. In fact, it is so predictable that plants rely on this signal to keep track of the seasons and to flower at the right time, a phenomenon called photoperiodic flowering. For a broader introduction to photoperiodic flowering, please refer to the previous tutorial. After decades of experiments, a sophisticated model explaining how the long day plant Arabidopsis thaliana controls flowering has been described. This is called the external coincidence model. According to this model, two signals are required for flowering. One is internal to the plant. This is a molecular signal provided by the circadian clock. The other is external to the plant and is triggered by sunlight. For flowering to occur, both signals need to coincide. For Arabidopsis, this can only happen during the summer when the daytime is longer than nighttime. Now, let's dig into the molecular aspects of photoperiodic flowering in Arabidopsis. Flowering locus T, or FT, is the key signal protein required for flowering. When FT molecules accumulate up to a certain threshold, they trigger flowering. Induction of the FT gene itself is mainly governed by the constans protein, or CO. Because it is a positive regulator, when CO proteins accumulate, the expression of FT is triggered. In turn, the expression of CO is regulated by a family of proteins called CDFs, which stands for cycling DOF factors. CDFs are negative regulators of CO expression. As their name indicates, CDF protein abundance cycles because their expression is regulated by the circadian clock. In the morning, high CDF concentrations repress CO expression, resulting in low CO protein levels. However, by the end of the afternoon, the pool of CDF proteins gets degraded, which alleviates the repression of CO expression and results in high CO protein levels by the end of the day. Let's go backward in this pathway one more time. Take a deep breath. We're almost there. The quantity of CDF protein is regulated by a complex of two proteins, FKF1 and GI. FKF1 and GI are directly regulated by the clock, which confers a daily oscillation of the protein quantities. At the end of the day, FKF1 and GI form a complex that degrades CDF proteins, thereby facilitating the expression of CO. But I know what you're thinking. Why does this scenario not occur during short days? What about the need for coincidence between the clock and light signaling? What about the external coincidence model? To understand, let's compare what happens under long day versus short day conditions. The light signal resets the clock every day, conferring a 24-hour rhythm no matter the season. But due to the change in photoperiod throughout the year, the cycling profiles of protein quantities vary. In other words, exactly when and how much of each protein is produced varies with the photoperiod. During a long day, the expression of FKF1 and GI is synchronized, which results in high quantities of the FKF1-GI complex. But during a short day, their expression is desynchronized. Because the protein ratio is unbalanced, not much of the FKF1-GI complex can form. On top of that, the complex can only be formed when FKF1 is activated by light, and more precisely, by blue light, because FKF1 is a blue light receptor. As a result, during a short day, an insufficient amount of FKF1-GI complex is produced. The consequence is that CDF proteins undergo less degradation during a short day. Even so, by the end of a short day, the quantity of CDF protein decreases due to clock regulation. This daily decrease could potentially allow a substantial amount of CO protein to be formed, like it does during long days. However, CO also requires light stabilization, which means that, at the end of short days, CO protein quantity remains low because there is no light to stabilize the CO protein generated. Ultimately, during short days, not enough FT is produced to reach the critical threshold, whereas during long days, the FT protein level builds up day after day until it reaches the threshold above which flowering is triggered. In summary, three factors contribute to the high levels of FT protein production during long days. First, the coordinated expression of FKF1 and GI thanks to the circadian clock. Second, FKF1-GI complex stabilization by light. And finally, CO protein stabilization by light. This whole process occurs in the leaves. Once FT is produced, it travels to the bud, located in the center of the Arabidopsis rosette. Here, FT triggers the developmental process that results in the production of flowers.